Can I ask you to stand with me, if you would, as we turn to the scriptures and we continue our look at the Gospel of Mark, the coming, cleansing, cursing, and conflict, and taking for a subject this morning, the Sadducees ask about the resurrection. We're in Mark chapter 12, and we're beginning our reading this morning in verse 18, and I invite you to read along with me. And Sadducees came to him who say that there is no resurrection. And they asked him a question, saying, Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife, but leaves no child, the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. There were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and when he died, left no offspring. And the second took her and died, leaving no offspring. And the third likewise. And the seven left no offspring. Last of all, the woman also died. In the resurrection, when they rise again, whose wife will she be? For the seven had her as wife. Jesus said to them, Is this not the reason you are wrong? Because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God. For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. And as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him, saying, I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. You are quite wrong. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, today as we come to the text, we are humbled. The wisdom wherein Jesus answered the questions of those who desired to entrap him is marvelous. And Father, we pray today that as we look deeply at this passage, that you will show us the hope that we have in Christ Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that that hope will continue to have an impact in our lives as Christians and how we live, but also in how we share our faith and our hope with others. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. And so here we find the Sadducees coming to Jesus with a question. The Sadducees, who were they? Well, they were members of the Sanhedrin, and you'll recall that that was the ruling council of Israel, their supreme court, if you will. The Sadducees were the aristocracy. They were the privileged, those who came from influential families, and primarily they were comprised of the priestly caste. They didn't believe in the resurrection. They did not believe in angels. They did not believe in spirits. They did not believe in the future judgment. And we could take some time this morning to talk about those things that they didn't believe. And I find it rather peculiar because they based all of their approach to religion on the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. How then did they not believe in angels? Because even in the book of the Pentateuch, we find angels. You'll recall that the Lord, during his appearance to Abraham, the Lord with two messengers, two angels, told Abraham what God was about to do to the twin cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So, not that we're going to speak of that today, but just to show as a sidebar that there was some discrepancy, some inconsistencies in what they said they believed and what they truly believed. They only accepted the Pentateuch, the first five books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And so they then rejected the oral tradition that was held to by the Pharisees. You see, the Sadducees considered themselves to be cultured, sophisticated, beyond those fanciful notions of childhood like angels, spirits, resurrection. Does that sound familiar? You see, they were too sophisticated, too cultured to believe in such things that require faith. And so they looked at the common people as simpletons, as gullible. And they come to Jesus and they approach him with a question, not because they're really seeking truth, but like the Pharisees that we spoke of last week, they have brought a question to Jesus in order to discredit him. You see, they believe that there's no such thing as the resurrection, and they want to show how utterly foolish they think Jesus is, because, of course, Jesus does believe in resurrection. But what they're not expecting is that he's going to give them an answer that is going to completely foil their attempts and leave them stunned, just as he did the Pharisees before them. Well, they come to him and they bring him this question in order to trip him up. And unlike the Pharisees' question being political in nature, the question of the Sadducees is theological in nature. It involves what has been called the leveret marriage, leveret. It comes from the Latin lever, meaning brother. And it's based on Deuteronomy 25, verses 5 through 10. It was a social network for widows. Because you've got to remember, back in those days, there was no such thing as government assistance, no such thing as welfare, that if a widow, you know, grew old and she did not have a son to take care of her, she would be destitute. Enter the leveret marriage. And what that simply said was that if a woman were to be left as a widow, then the brother of her deceased husband was to take her as his wife. And if there was no brother, then it would be the next nearest male relative. And that the offspring of that union, the first son, would be named after the deceased man and would be raised as the deceased man's son. And so in doing this, it provided for the widow in her old age, it continued the family name, but most importantly, it protected the family inheritance. Because you'll recall when God brought the children of Israel into the promised land, the land was divided. And it was, each portion was given to families and to tribes. And so it was very important for the protection of the inheritance for the family that this offspring would exist. And so the Sadducees develop an outlandish story based on their disbelief in the resurrection. And they've been talking about this and thinking about this for quite some time, and so they want to come to Jesus and they feel like this is our one shot to discredit him. How are we going to do it? Let's bring up the leveret marriage. And they have this story designed where there are seven brothers, one after the next, that marry this widow and die. And finally, the widow dies. And many male lives were saved. But it's a crazy story that they bring to him because they're trying to trap him, trying to say, well, come on, Jesus, if you really believe in the resurrection, then when the, you know, widow is raised and all of these brothers are raised, whose wife is she going to be? Because each one had her as a wife. And their very comments that set the stage for this question show that they don't understand the nature of the resurrection at all. They assume that when you are raised, you'll be just like you were before you died. In fact, they had elaborate schemes to explain how they believed resurrection, or I should say how they discounted resurrection because they didn't believe it. And part of their scheming was because of some of the ridiculous notions about resurrection that even the Pharisees themselves held. One example would be the Pharisees believed that all Jews would be raised in Israel. Didn't matter if they died in a foreign land, they would be raised in Israel. Well, you say, well, how in the world could they be raised in Israel if they died in a foreign land and their body was not brought back to Israel? Well, there was this scheme, this notion that there were these elaborate tunnels deep in the earth, and that once a Jew was buried, their body would tumble down to Jerusalem or to Israel underground. And that way they could be raised. Now you can see why when you had such ridiculous notions about resurrection, the Sadducees would say that's ludicrous. Well, the point is they were rejecting resurrection in part due to some extra-biblical understanding of what resurrection was all about. These notions, these concepts that were contrived from human imagination. But they threw the baby out with the bathwater. Because there were these crazy ideas about resurrection, they simply didn't believe in resurrection at all. And so they come with this elaborate story, a story that demonstrates not only their disbelief, but their disdain for the doctrine of resurrection. And it also underscores their pride. I mean, the attitude behind this question is, who could believe such nonsense? The attitude says, we're beyond such fanciful, childish beliefs. Come on. You live, you die, that's it. And if you want a good life while you're here, then you need the blessing of God. And in order to get the blessing of God, you need to abide by the law of Moses. End of story. It's an attitude of pride and arrogance. Well, Jesus answers their two-pronged question with a counter-question. He says, is this not the reason you are wrong? Because you know neither the Scriptures nor the power of God. You see, in reality, their question displayed not only their pride, not only their contempt for the doctrine of the resurrection, in reality, their question displayed their ignorance of the Scripture and their ignorance of the power of God. It showed that they were self-deceived. They saw themselves as sophisticated experts, but in truth, their clue bag was empty. They didn't have a clue. Jesus' response, is this not the reason you are wrong? Because you know neither the Scriptures nor the power of God. It is a stinging rebuke. Why? Because the Sadducees were largely comprised of the priests. These were the ones who were considered the experts in the Scripture, that they devoted their lives to the sacred text. They were the experts in the law. And so Jesus hits them right where it counts and says, you do not know the Scriptures. Well, they knew the Scriptures, but they didn't understand the Scriptures. They knew what was there, but somehow it went right over their head. They understood the letter of the law quite frequently, but they missed the spirit of the law. And then Jesus adds to that, you do not know the power of God. You see, they didn't believe in the resurrection, even though they prided themselves on believing the Pentateuch, Genesis through Deuteronomy. How ironic, for that is the book that teaches us about Abraham. And how Abraham and Sarah brought forth Ishmael and Isaac when Sarah's womb was as good as dead. She was beyond child-raising years. And yet, God touched her womb, and she gave birth to those sons. So you would think that they would just automatically extrapolate from that, that God has the power of life. That if he can give life to a womb that is as good as dead, certainly he can raise the dead to life. They knew the stories of Scripture, and yet they did not truly understand them. Nor did they understand the power of God. But then Jesus develops his argument even further. And he bases his argument not just on the Scriptures at large, but watch this. In his wisdom, what does he base his argument on? The Pentateuch! The very portion of Scripture that the Sadducees hold to as being the only Scripture that is fully trustworthy. So Jesus develops his argument from the Pentateuch, demonstrating his understanding of the Scripture and the power of God. And the first issue that he addresses is resurrection. He says, when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. And so the first words out of the Lord's mouth is his reaffirmation that the dead are indeed raised. He doesn't say if the dead are raised, maybe the dead are raised, if possible the dead are, no. He says when the dead are raised. So he affirms the resurrection of the body. And he's not talking about resuscitation, but resurrection. And there's a difference. Because up till this point, Jesus has already raised three people from the dead. But the resurrection that he is now speaking of is not that resuscitation. You see, when he raised Jairus' daughter, when he raised the son of the widow of Nain, when he raised Lazarus' good friend, that was a reanimation. It was a resuscitation. The difference was they were raised in their corruptible bodies and would then again face natural death. But here, Jesus is talking about something that is wholly different, the resurrection of the dead. There's a fundamental difference between resurrection life and earthly life. The Bible talks about it at great length, and Apostle Paul speaks of it in great detail. The earthly life is mortal. The resurrection life is immortal. The earthly life is sown in dishonor. The resurrection life is raised in glory. The earthly life is sown in weakness. The resurrection life is raised in power. The earthly life is sown in a natural body, whereas the resurrection life is raised in a spiritual body. And what is raised is imperishable. And then Jesus elaborates on this by comparing the spiritual body of those who are raised to angels. Now, that doesn't mean that when you die, you become an angel. You know, you hear these stories that people come up with. Well, they're an angel now. No, they're not. They're not an angel. Angels are a completely different creature from man. Only mankind was created in the image of God. So what is Jesus talking about when he compares the resurrected life to angels? Well, he's simply saying that they are not married, nor are they given in marriage. This was back in the days when marriages were arranged. People were given in marriage. Mom and dad decided who you were going to marry. If you ever watched The Fiddler on the Roof, it's a cute little spin on that whole concept. He says, when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. So the question is, why do those raised neither marry nor are given in marriage? There's a couple of reasons. The first, there is no death. And so there is no reason to propagate the race any longer. You see, in this way, those who are raised are like the angels. The angels do not die. They are immortal. And so the angels were never given the power to procreate. There was no need. There was a fixed number of angels that were created. They do not die. That number is fixed. Marriage was an institute established by God whose primary function was the propagation of the species. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Why? Because natural man dies. Natural man dies. There was a need to propagate the race. The second reason, there is perfect intimacy with God. Perfect intimacy. Now, when God created man, he said, it is not good for man to what? Be alone. It's not good for man to be alone. And all of the married men said, amen. You better say amen. Your wife's sitting next to you. Amen. Not good for man to be alone. Why? Because we were created as social creatures. And man's greatest intimacy with regards to his human needs is met in marriage. And yet there's a greater need for intimacy even beyond that. And that is the spiritual intimacy with God. To know God and to be with God and to enjoy his presence immediately. even as Adam and Eve did before the fall, when God would come and walk with them in the cool of the day. But at the resurrection, when those who have died in Christ are raised, they will be clothed in their spiritual body, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then we will experience a spiritual intimacy with our Creator like we have never known. Can you say amen? No need to propagate the race, because death no longer has any power over us. And we are in perfect, intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. That greater need of spiritual intimacy is fully met, as God Himself will be our God and dwell among us. Won't it be wonderful? And so Jesus affirms resurrection life, and then He turns it on these men and uses the Pentateuch to prove it. I love it. It's just, the wisdom of Jesus is absolutely staggering. He not only gives them a good answer, He gives them an answer right from the books of the Bible that they're saying proves that there's no resurrection. And so again, verses 26 and 7, He says, "As for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses," that's the Pentateuch, "in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him, saying, 'I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob.' He is not the God of the dead, but of the living." So He draws right from the Pentateuch this story of the burning bush. It's when Moses was tending sheep in Midian before God called him to go free the children of Israel from Pharaoh. And one day he's out there and he's tending his sheep, and he sees this bush out of the corner of his eye. It's on fire, but as he takes a closer look, the bush is not being consumed. And so the Bible tells us that he turns aside to take a closer look. And as he does, the voice of God comes from the bush. And he declares himself, identifying himself to Moses as being the God of Abraham. He says, "I am the God of Abraham, and I am the God of Isaac, and I am the God of Jacob." Why is that significant? It's significant because by the time Moses has this experience, the patriarchs are long dead. Wouldn't it then have been more correct to say, "I was the God of Abraham, and I was the God of Isaac, and I was the God of Jacob"? Well, yes, it would have been more correct, except in God's estimation, they were not dead. You see, if He were to say, "I was the God of Abraham," then it would have only been fitting to say, "They were." But when He says, "I am the God of Abraham, I am the God of Isaac, I am the God of Jacob," then what you have to say about them is, "They are." Do you see the difference? And then Jesus sets the nail by saying, "He is not the God of the dead, but of the living." You see, when a human being dies, that human being does not cease to exist. And those who die in the Lord go into the presence of God. The Apostle Paul talked about it. He said, "To be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord." He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And today, Helen Shalito, our good friend and dear sister, is in the immediate presence of her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For He is the God of the living and not of the dead. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." And then he called his friend Lazarus from the grave. And the dead heard his voice and came back to life. And they had to free him from his grave clothes. He is the God of the living and not the God of the dead. It's amazing that when Jesus made this statement, it was a mere 4 days later that he himself would experience resurrection. This was Wednesday of Passion Week. Friday, they would put him in a tomb. And Sunday morning, he would rise from the dead. And as Christians, we rejoice in Christ's resurrection. Because he was raised, we too shall be raised. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Sadly, the Sadducees were not the only ones to disbelieve resurrection. There are many people throughout the ages that have disbelieved resurrection. And even today, many refuse to believe in the resurrection. Paul addressed a group of Christians that were struggling with their belief of resurrection from the dead. In 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 14, he said, "How can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain." You see, as Christians, we have no excuse for not believing in the resurrection of the dead. We have ample proof. We have the Word of God. We have the testimony of the apostles. We have the resurrection of Jesus Christ himself. We have plenty of evidence to believe in the resurrection as Christians. But God is so gracious that he even gives evidence out of general revelation for those who don't believe the Word of God. You say, well, what is that? Paul speaks of it a little bit later in this same chapter. He draws his illustration from the world of agriculture. So you've got to kind of put on a farmer's cap as you're reading this passage. He says, "What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body." So you want evidence of the resurrection beyond the scripture? What'd you eat for breakfast this morning? Did you have a donut? Did you have a bagel? Did you have a piece of toast? That flour comes from grain that is milled. And grain comes from the stalks of wheat or other plants. And those plants come from kernels that have been sown into the ground and have died and then have brought forth new life. And the evidence is given to us in the very things that we eat. There is a resurrection from the dead. Well, the resurrection teaches us many important truths, but I want to focus just on two this morning, two important truths that we learn from the resurrection. What does resurrection teach us about man? Number one, it teaches us mankind possesses an inherent dignity. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, you are dignified. Now tell them you're dignified like you mean it. I mean, some of you said that with a smile on your face. Not trying to start any fights in here this morning. You are dignified. There is an inherent dignity of being a human being. Human life is sacred. God sent his Son into the world to save sinners, and aren't we eternally grateful for that? But I want you to notice that when the Father decided to send the Son, he did not send the Son as a fully developed 30-year-old man, did he? He sent his Son into the womb of a virgin, Mary. And in so doing, he sanctified the very process of human development. There is an inherent dignity and a sacredness to human life from conception to the grave. He sanctified the very process of human development itself. Human life stands apart from all other life, including the lives of angels. For only human beings were created in the image of God. Human life is sacred, and mankind, being the possessor of human life, possesses an inherent dignity. And Christ's resurrection confirms this truth. Jesus demonstrated the high value that God places on the physical body when he raised his body from the dead. You say, well, I thought that God the Father raised Jesus. He did. And so did the Spirit. And so did the Son. You can't draw hard lines, for the Trinity is three persons in one. And the Bible tells us very clearly that God the Father raised Jesus from the dead. And Paul tells us, if that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, it shall quicken your mortal body. In other words, you too will be raised. And then Jesus told Pontius Pilate, no man takes my life, freely I lay it down, and I will take it up again. Father, Son, Spirit. We should never be surprised when we find the three persons of the Trinity working together in perfect unity and in perfect harmony. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead proves the high value that God places on the physical body of man. Because Jesus could have left the body in the grave and simply returned to the Father in spirit, but he didn't. The body was raised and gloriously transformed. And one day ours will be raised and gloriously transformed as well. We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Jesus' body rose from the dead. For when he stood before the disciples, he told doubting Thomas, place your hand here in my side. You see that I have flesh and bone, which a ghost does not have. And then after ministering to those men, he ate fish, physical thing, and then passed through the wall. In the glorified state, he had control over his physical body right down to the molecular level. Now, we're beginning to understand how he could do that a little bit better now with modern science, because we recognize that when you go down to the subatomic level, even physical matter has space in it. And Jesus, controlling his atoms, passes through a solid stone wall. Controlling his atoms, he eats fish, and the fish went with him. It's remarkable. But his resurrection confirms the high value that God the Father places on our physical bodies. Now, that's a strong argument against Gnosticism, and we won't take time for that today. But what we do with these bodies really does matter to God. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. It's the first important truth. The second important truth that we learn, Christians possess eternal life. Say it with me. Christians possess eternal life. Isn't that awesome? Christians possess eternal life. And eternal life doesn't simply mean life without end. It's not just a quantitative life that we possess. It is a qualitatively different life that we possess. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And when we come to Jesus in faith, believing that God rose him from the dead, and we are gloriously saved and converted, we are given eternal life. Eternal life. Our conversion date is the date that we are born again, born of the Spirit, given eternal life, and that eternal life begins at that point. But if we're fully to understand what eternal life involves, then we need to understand a concept that theology speaks of as being federal headship. Federal headship. What in the world does federal headship mean? I want you to hang with me, and I want you to pay close attention, because if you grasp this concept, it will thrill your heart. It will radically impact your view of salvation. It'll radically impact your desire to share your hope with others. Federal headship, what does it mean? Well, federal headship speaks of one as being the federal representative of others. One as being the federal representative of others. So it's that representative capacity. federal headship. It's illustrated by the power of attorney. I read the story of a pastor who had sold his house, but he and his wife had already booked a missions trip, and they were going to be out of town when the closing was supposed to happen. And so he was talking to his realtor. The realtor said, "Not a problem. All you need to do is find a person, a good close friend, that you feel comfortable giving them the power of attorney. Then they can sign all the documents for you." He's like, "Really? That's it? Yep, that's it." So they went to an attorney, had the papers drawn up, gave the power of attorney to this dear friend, and they went off on the mission field. And when the closing date came, guess what happened? That friend sat down and signed 150,000 papers, it seems. You ever go through a closing? He signed them, but it was binding legally. Why? Because of federal headship. He had been assigned the power of attorney. And now when that friend signed all those closing papers, it was as if the pastor himself had signed all those papers, and it was completely and totally legally binding. Now, when we turn to the scriptures, the first place that we see federal headship is all the way back again in the Pentateuch, in the book of Genesis. And there we find in the Garden of Eden, that when Adam sinned, guess who else sinned? We sinned. All of us sinned. You say, "Well, how did we sin in Adam?" Because we were yet in his loins. And when we were in his loins and Adam sinned, he was the federal head of humanity. And because he sinned, we sinned. And this is why through sin, death entered the world, and because all have sinned, all die. You see, the Apostle Paul goes into great detail with this in Romans, and we won't get into it today, but in the fifth chapter of Romans, this concept of federal headship, he talks about how death reigned even from Adam to Moses. What happened with Moses? The law came. The point that he's making is that death reigned even before the law was given. Even before people had a conscious awareness of transgressing particular laws of God, they sinned, they died. Death reigned from Adam to Moses. And because all sin, all die. You say, "Well, what about the baby?" That's the perfect illustration. The baby who dies, and what a grievous experience that is. And many of us here in the congregation have experienced that. That baby dies not because that baby was personally culpable for any sin. They weren't even old enough to know what the concept means. So why did they die? Because they were united in Adam. They were united with Adam in humanity. And because Adam was the federal representative of humanity, sin passed to the human race. So we, as the psalmist puts it, are conceived in iniquity. In other words, this human race is now polluted. It's polluted. We have all sinned in Adam. Paul explains it a little bit better in Romans 5:12. "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all sinned." Verse 18, "Therefore, as one trespass led to the condemnation for all men," watch this, "so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men." Oh, hallelujah. You see, when it comes to federal headship and we start talking about our guilt because of our association with Adam, we don't like that. And we recoil and we say, "That's not fair." But listen, the good news is just as we are federally united with Adam in our humanity, we are glorified and united with Christ in his resurrection. Can you say amen? Amen. Paul elaborates further in 1 Corinthians. He says, "Thus it is written, the first Adam became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven." We in our humanity are related to Adam, but we in our Christianity are related to Christ. Can you say amen? Our union with Adam in the human race results in death. But our union with Christ in his kingdom results in our resurrection. Hallelujah. What does that mean for our salvation? It means we don't do anything to save ourselves. We are saved because of the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And now those who are in Christ Jesus are new creatures. The old has passed away and the new has come. He saves us wholly and completely, not by works of righteousness that we have done, but according to his mercy, by the shedding of his precious blood. Can you say amen? Amen. So what are the implications? Let me just leave you with one today. The implication that just hit me so hard: we have hope. We have hope. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and 14, it says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep." Praise God. Praise God. So those who die in the Lord will be raised in the Lord. Our baptism illustrates it so beautifully. Baptized into his death, raised into newness of life. Because he left an empty tomb, we too will leave an empty tomb. That gives us hope like the world does not have. And that hope affects how we face death, but may that hope also affect how we face life. There have been great men that have risen to prominence in many different fields and that have left a name for themselves because of the way that they have influenced humanity. And if we were to take the time this morning, I'm sure we could come up with examples of men that have done that in every field, from art to the sciences to medicine. But there are two men that have impacted the human race and influenced it more than any other. And those two men are Adam and Jesus Christ. Through Adam, sin and death entered the world. But through Jesus, forgiveness of sin and eternal life has come. So may it not only affect, may this hope not only affect how we face death, but how we live our lives, with a willingness to share the hope that we have with others, that they too can know the God that we know and enjoy the eternal life that we've been given. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, once again we are astounded with the wisdom of Jesus and with the power that he had as he explained to the Sadducees and to us resurrection. Our hearts are warmed this morning as we contemplate this great truth that those who are asleep in the Lord will return with the Lord. For truly, death is not the end. And Father, I pray for those who are grieving and in mourning today that you will grip their hearts with this comforting truth. But I also pray, Lord, for those that maybe don't even know you yet, that they will realize the beautiful simplicity of this truth this morning and reach out in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ and ask, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. I believe in you. And having so done that, Lord, that their lives will be forever changed as they receive forgiveness and eternal life in you. And Father, as we prepare to leave this place in just a few moments, I ask that this truth would go with us. The hope that we have will affect not only how we face death, but how we live life and share the hope that we have with others. As we now give back to you in these tithes and offering a portion of that which you've given to us, I pray that you'll bless these gifts and give us wisdom to know how best to invest them. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you as you give to